Hey there. So CentOS 8 has been out for a little while now, and one of the things that they made as a decision when they went from 7 to 8 is that KDE would no longer be included with CentOS. It's now dependent on the EPEL packages, which are extra packages from the Fedora repository that are compiled to work with Red Hat Enterprise Linux or CentOS. So I decided that I would take a look and see if I could install KDE on there. And then I figured, hey, my fourth most viewed video is whether CentOS 7 works as a desktop distro. So I said, hey, maybe there's a lot of interest here in CentOS. So maybe I would go ahead and make a video showing how to get KDE installed. And then probably a follow-up video to see, is CentOS 8 a good desktop distro? It's become more important for me. The reason I'm checking out trying to install KDE 5 on CentOS 8 is that my wife's Ubuntu LTS, it's cool they use screen there. Her LTS installed Ubuntu is acting kind of funky, and it's getting closer to where I might actually have to reinstall, and I figured I'd really like to use CentOS if possible, because it would last a really long time, even longer potentially than an LTS. Install. And so what I did here is because the default CentOS comes with GNOME, and I figured there's no point in cloud getting things full of GNOME for no reason, I would go ahead and just do the boot install and then from there go ahead and install KDE. So let's take a look at our installation source here. Right, so this is a boot source. So it looks like I probably have to get networking working first. So let's turn on the NIC. This will be CentOS 8 test.net domain. I'll apply that. We'll be done with that. So now you can see that the software thing here is getting fixed up. While that's waiting, let's go to the destination. We'll put on this virtual disk that we've got here. Let it go automatically. I don't need to worry about encryption. This is just a VM that's going to be blown away after I'm done. All right, so it's giving me the closest mirror. Now, additional repos. Let's go ahead and put in Apple. See if we can do this now. It may or may not work this way. Let me take a look and see. Repository, actually, no, because I've got a VM that I need to, an RPM that I need to install. I don't know why I said VM, an RPM I need to install later, so that's fine. So software selection. All right, so there's server with GUI, which has all that stuff. Server, I'm going to do minimal install. This one's going to come with GNOME stuff. This is if I want to host virtualization stuff, which I don't want to do nested virtualization right now, and a custom OS with a bunch of random stuff. Oh, guest agents, that's cool. If I do minimal, do I still get guest? Okay, I'm going to install guest agents since I'm doing this in a VM. Standard, of course. Actually, I'm not sure about standard, of course. Let's say guest agents for sure. Headless management, which is probably cockpit. Cockpit is really awesome. I should probably do a little video on that, but I'm not sure. We'll see. Okay, and let's leave it at these two. We'll hit done. All right. So that gives us everything we need. All right, so now I need to create my user and set the root password. So I will do that. I'm just going to pause the video for a minute. All right, so the installation is running. It's downloading the RPMs it's going to need, because again, this is a boot disk. There is literally nothing on this disk. It's not even a minimal disk. So the disk itself only takes about 500 megs. It was a super fast download. I did it on BitTorrent. I like to do that to support the distros and keep their bandwidth from going crazy whenever I can. For some of the Linux Fedora 31 ISOs, I've got like a 6x sharing ratio, so I've shared 6 times more than I've downloaded, which is really good. And again, helping to reduce the bandwidth that's needed. It's kind of a shame that for a lot of distros, they don't really advertise BitTorrent as much as they used to. They kind of just point people to the regular downloads, and maybe that's to make it a little bit easier for the non-techie, but does, of course, increase their bandwidth needs. So I'm not going to make you watch all of this. I'm going to pause it, and we'll come back once it's installed. All right. Good thing I paused that recording, because with the VM resources I've got on this VM, that took half an hour or more. So let's go ahead and reboot. And we should have a minimal system. I also went ahead and installed CentOS on my Acer Aspire. I used to have CentOS 7 on there, which is actually one of the best distros I've ever had on there. Everything worked perfectly. The suspend worked, the touchpad worked, everything worked. So I said, all right, there isn't really an upgrade path from 7 to 8. But there were a few libraries that were kind of making it annoying. It had some old versions of things, or it couldn't run certain things. In particular, I was trying last May to get WeChat Matrix to work on there, which needed OLM and a certain version of Go, and that wasn't working. So I said, all right, why not go ahead and go to the newest version and give that a shot. All right, while this is booting up, I'm going to pause. All right, so we're all nice and logged in here. And this web console is pretty awesome. That's the cockpit thing I was talking about. We're not going to worry about that right now. What we want to do is enable Apple. So we're going to do sudo dnf install and this URL. Okay, hopefully I did that without any typos. All right, looks like potentially didn't have any typos. We'll see what happens. Alright, so I'll hit yes. And after this is done installing, they also recommend enabling power tools. So I'll do that afterwards. So the way you do that is DNF config manager set enabled power tools. Alright, very cool. So now let's see. I wanted to try and see if we could get it to show up in the group list, because that would be the easiest way to do this. All right, so let's see here. Let's try sudo dnf group list and see what we get. It checks all of its repos. If this goes off the screen, then I'll redo it with piping it to less. Let's see. Come on, gonna get some groups. I got some groups. All right, so KDE Plasma Workspaces is a group that's available. Rock on. So let's do DNF group install. All right, I'm gonna do quotes. You probably need quotes since there's a space in there. Plasma Workspaces. Oh. Of course, as everything else, sudo. Boom. Let's hit yes. And there it goes. And I will pause while this downloads and installs. We'll see what happens afterwards. All right, just for completion's sake, I want to show that you have to accept some keys the first time you're installing stuff. Now, of course, the whole point of keys, here's the Apple key, is to make sure you actually check that key against the website to make sure that you haven't had your website spoofed. Whether or not you want to do that is up to you and depends on how important this machine is to you. Being this is a VM that I'm going to blow away soon, I really don't care. There are some exploits that break out of VMs, but for the most part, you know, VMs are relatively safe. If this was production machine, you definitely would want to check that key to make sure that it hasn't been compromised. All right, so now that that's all installed, let's actually try rebooting and see if we've ended up with some kind of SDDM or other login manager installed for launching KDE. And I'm going to pause and we'll see what comes back when we come back. All right, so it dropped us to the console. We'll just log in. Alright, let's see if we have SDDM installed. Okay, so it is installed, we just don't have a graphical boot enabled. Alright, so let's give this a shot. Let's do system control set default, and then we'll do graphical target. Okay, I need to authenticate because I'm not root. Looks like that worked. Let's reboot again. Okay, that didn't work. Not quite sure why, but let's see if we can figure it out here. Looks like maybe X is starting, I'm not sure, because there were some warnings on the screen there. And it didn't take us to a graphical target, which I thought was kind of somewhat alarming, but it's doing something now. Going to pause again so that you don't have to wait. Okay, it looks like it might take a little more work for KDE. According to a website I was looking at here, what we need to do is echo exec start KDE. Okay. All right, let's see if that works. All right, I'm not sure if that fixed it or not, but essentially, I logged in, I typed start X, and this time I got the KDE logo as opposed to nothing. Big spike in the VM CPU. See if this goes anywhere. Hey, look at that. Very cool. It's the latest KDE background in Fedora. Or maybe it might be one or two behind, but not bad. Looks like we're making some progress here. Again, the fact that this is going slowly is probably more a matter of my VM and my system than what you would expect running KDE on CentOS. So here's the little settings icon. I'm expecting some more stuff to pop up. All right, so now we have KDE. Running a bit slowly. Let me see if I can fix that by making sure that it's not trying to use 3D acceleration because this is a VM, not because I don't believe that CentOS wouldn't be able to do it. The fact that it's doing this leads me to believe that's probably at least part of the issue. All right, let's take a quick look here at the, where is it? It'll take me a second to remember where the heck this is found. Might be best if I search for it rather than clicking around, given how slowly things are going. Okay, under desktop behavior. Nope, definitely not here. Let's. So I don't think we want OpenGL. I think we just want XRender. We want Instant. Let's apply. Hopefully that makes things run a little better. Yep, this seems to be a lot faster. So let's see what applications we've got by default. I guess I spoke too soon about it being faster, but again, blame my VM and my busy, busy system. Okay, not many applications, but that's okay. We start with a minimal install, so kind of Arch Linux style, you can build it up to where you want to be and not have anything that you don't necessarily need. But looks like it's relatively easy just to get KDE going with CentOS. And of course, you know, you'd want to take the time to debug why SDDM isn't running and all those type of things. But at least, you know, you can get to a desktop. It's even got the little notification here that there's an update. So looks like, even though I literally just installed this, there's an Apple release upgrade to do. And so that's looking pretty good. I think I'm going to go ahead and use this as the basis of a system to see, can I use CentOS 8 to replace Ubuntu for my wife? And so expect that video to come at some point. So thanks for watching this one, and I hope it was very helpful and instructive. See you next time. Bye.